update, I talked to Betty Winterbottom the other day. She's doing well. She thought she might be here today, but as of now, I don't see her. Also talked to Pat Warszewski, and she says she's coming along. She says she's had a few setbacks along the way. Uses a walker to get around, has limited use of her one arm, but she said she is determined to get back to church sooner than later, so that's a good sign. She has a good attitude about it. Anyone else have anything? If not, let us begin our service. Join me in the call to worship. We were created in relationship and for relationship.
We are created for community.
God knew it was not right for us to be alone.
We are created for community.
Through Jesus Christ, God entered into human relationship with us.
We are created for community.
We rejoice in our unity with all humanity.
We are created for community.
Holy and gracious God, let us be open to your presence among your people, those gathered for worship, and all your people throughout your creation. May we receive you fully and respond to you wholeheartedly.
Amen.
God made flesh, bone of our bone, we confess that we think we can go it alone, that we try to do it all, that in doing so we neglect the gifts that you have given us. The bone of our bone, the flesh of our flesh, the bodies you created, and the relationships you created for us.
Jesus Christ, you who have lived in a human body, call us to
remind us that in you we are one.
Awaken us respect for one another, and celebrate with us the diversity within that unity.
May it be so now and forever. Amen. You are the divine creation, and it is not right for you to be alone. Know now that you are forgiven and called back into relationship with God and with one another.
Amen.
Let us praise God. Someone has testified
for them.
You have made them for a little while lower than angels. You have crowned them with glory and honor, subjecting all things under their feet. Now, in subjecting all things to them, God left nothing outside their control. As it is, we do not yet see everything in subjection to them. But we do see Jesus, who for a little while was made lower than the angels, now crowned with glory and honor because of the suffering of death, so that by the grace of God he might taste death for everyone. It was fitting that God, for whom and through whom all things exist, in bringing many children to glory, should make the pioneer of their salvation perfect through suffering. For the one who sanctifies and those who are sanctified all have one Father. For this reason, Jesus is not ashamed to call to them brothers and sisters, saying, I will proclaim your name to my brothers and sisters. In the midst of congregation, I will praise you. And our gospel lesson comes from the 10th chapter of Mark. Some Pharisees came, and to test him, they asked, is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife? He answered, what did Moses command you? They said, Moses allowed a man to write a certificate of dismissal to divorce her. But Jesus said to them, because of your hardness of heart, he wrote this commandment for you. But from the beginning of the creation, God made them male and female. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. So they are no longer two, but one flesh. Therefore, what God has joined together, let no one separate. Then in his house, the disciples asked him again about this matter. He said to them, whoever divorces his wife and marries another commits adultery against her. And if she divorces her husband and marries another, she commits adultery. People were bringing little children to him in order that he might touch them, and the disciples spoke sternly to them. But when Jesus saw this, he was indignant and said to them, let the little children come to me, do not stop them. For it is to such as these that the kingdom of God belongs. Truly I tell you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child will never enter it. And he took them up in his arms, laid his hands on them, and blessed them.
Almost everything you can imagine goes wrong for Alexander that particular day. He wakes up with gum stuck in his hair, slips and falls getting out of bed, is the only kid at the breakfast table without a prize in his cereal box. At school, the teacher does not appreciate Alexander's drawing of an invisible castle. She then faults him for singing too loudly and for skipping 16 as he counts to 20. The dentist finds a cavity in Alexander's tooth. The elevator door shuts hard on Alexander's foot. His brother Anthony pushes Alexander into a mud puddle, and his brother Nick calls him a crybaby. And when Alexander punches Nick, his mom sees the punch, and she's mad, of course, at Alexander. Everything is wrong all day. Lima beans for dinner, soap in his eyes, a burned out night light, the cat choosing not to speak with him. This story about Alexander has come back to me many times in the last year and a half, when so much of what has happened has seemed no good and very bad. From the pandemic and all the associated upheaval and death, to climate change and all the associated upheaval and death, to the persistent problems of gun violence, poverty, addiction, rancorous politics. It's been an awful season in many ways. I think I'll move to Australia, says Alexander repeatedly throughout that book. He's not the only one to whom an escape is looking pretty good. The biblical character of Job has had an unbelievably horrible day, far worse than Alexander's or mine or yours. We find him today on a pile of ashes, where Job has gone to mourn all he lost. Oxen and donkeys captured by the Scythian army, sheep and servants consumed by lightning, camels carried off by Chaldean troops. Worst of all, unspeakably terrible, his sons and daughters are dead. They'd been feasting together in the eldest brother's house when the roof fell in and crushed them. And while Job is still reeling with this news, his own skin breaks out in painful, itchy sores. Imagine for a moment that you don't know the backstory, God's wager with the adversary, the story calls Satan. Thinking just about what happened on the ground, this story is unbelievably unfair. At the time it was first told, folks trusted that good people would have good lives. God rewarded folks that way. Everyone thought so. And in all the earth, there was no person better than Job. Job was righteous and faithful to God in the way that Snow White was kind and the fairest of them all. Job was perfect in his integrity. So what happens to him is, without question, undeserved and unjust. But we do know the backstory, which makes it even worse. Job is not just let down by God, he is betrayed by God. God has brought Job to ruin for no reason other than to use him as a chip in a wager with the adversary. Now, 7 sons and 3 daughters, countless servants, and who knows how many animals are dead at God's instigation and with God's permission. Samuel Ballantyne, who wrote a commentary on Job, calls this description of God, incited and manipulated by Satan, the most disturbing description in the whole Old Testament. It is a terrible, horrible story, without any of the humor of Alexander's story, with no place to escape and no hope that tomorrow will be better. I'll be honest. Part of me hates that this story is part of the scriptures. I don't believe that God makes bets about the fate of God's people. I'm here today because I believe in God's goodness, because I believe that God blesses us and has meant to bless all God made. From the beginning and forever, God intends to keep blessing the world. It is no good to imagine God like this. At the same time, part of me is grateful for this story, and my friend Patrick Wilson helped me to articulate why. He said that this story puts words and images to the times no story makes sense of what we're going through, when it isn't just a day or a week that is horrible, but everything is bad, everything is lost. Times you feel like you're being thrown around casually as a pair of dice, like there is some secret cosmic bet on what you'll do next and whether you'll make it. There is always someone feeling that way, says Archibald MacLeish in his play based on Job, a play called J.B., written in 1958. There is always someone playing Job, MacLeish said. There must be thousands, millions, and millions of humankind burned, crushed, broken, mutilated, slaughtered, and for what? For walking around in the world in the wrong skin, the wrong-shaped noses, eyelids, sleeping in the wrong night in the wrong city, London, Dresden, Hiroshima, these days maybe Kabul or Port-au-Prince. We've seen Job everywhere, his children dead, his work for nothing, counting his losses, scraping his boils. There is always someone playing Job, feeling, like Job, that her fate is undeserved and unjust, and then beginning to wonder, if fate is cruel, is God cruel too? Job will ask some hard questions in the chapters to come, That is part of his faithfulness. He dares to lament and doubt and rage at God. But what is remarkable and hopeful, I think, is that even as Job laments and rages, he sees that his story is not the whole story, but part of a larger and better story. It's the story of our faith, too, where God is present and worth talking to, where God cares for us, where God is powerful even in the midst of trouble and at work for our good. Thinking about people with faith like that got me to remembering Kelly Gissenander. Do you remember her? She was executed in Georgia a few years ago, and she sang Amazing Grace while she was injected with the poison that killed her. Even if you believe in capital punishment, even though you must be appalled she conspired to take a life, you might agree that her execution was particularly unfair. It was her lover who wielded the knife and committed the murder, not Kelly. He pled guilty and testified against her, so he got a life sentence. She got death row. While she was there, she was unquestionably rehabilitated. The guards in her prison, her fellow inmates, her family, all kinds of people have testified to the way that Kelly helped them, even saving their lives. Rehabilitation is the point of prison, right? Still, she was executed. One of Kelly's teachers in recent years said that Kelly's version of hope was a deep belief in the promises of God. And she clung to that belief, that she could sing of God's grace that had saved her, even as she was being killed. Reminds me of Job. Thinking globally, too, a story told by one of our Presbyterian Mission co-workers, Bob Rice, comes to mind. Bob attended the School of Reconciliation in Rwanda. There, the victims and perpetrators of genocide dared to believe that their story, horrible though it was not the whole story. They met together. Victims and perpetrators of genocide met together. They took to God their woundedness and pain, and they found in their worship an amazing kind of healing. They found freedom in their souls and found the grace to repent and forgive and work for reconciliation in their communities. Bob Rice thought, "My community in Congo is just as troubled and divided as this one." So he brought some 25 Congolese to Rwanda to learn how they did it, how they kept the horrible things they had done and suffered from defining them or defining God. It was such a transformative experience for this small group of Congolese. They took the practice home. They led their own school of reconciliation for the pastors, elders, and deacons of their region. Folks from all four tribes in the area attended. It was a powerful experience. One of them said it was like a hospital for his soul. Another said, "I came here with a wounded spirit. It was a long journey to come, but now I feel free." They said that the teachings helped them to make sense of their tribal and national identities and to see how those identities fit within the holy nation God is creating, where all tribes and tongues will worship and serve as one people. How did they get there? With a Job-like willingness to trust that their story of injustice and pain and anger was not the whole story, but that God offered them a better story they could come to know and to tell. World Communion Sunday began with such determination. It started in 1933, around the time that Hitler and Mussolini were proclaiming the Rome-Berlin Axis and Chiang Kai-shek declared war on Japan. The practice of worldwide communion began then, and really caught on during the Second World War. A pastor who was part of it said, "We were trying to hold the world together. Worldwide communion symbolized the effort to hold things together in a spiritual sense. It emphasized that we are one in the Spirit and the gospel of Jesus Christ." It's a different world today, except that we are still fighting, still wounded, still struggling to hold together, still reading and even experiencing terrible, horrible stories of our own. May we, like Joan, dare to trust that our stories are not the whole story, but that we too are part of the larger, better story of a God who is good, who means to give us good, and who can even make us good. May we tell that story together and let it shape us into people who are free and whole and one in Jesus Christ.
Let us pray. Lord, as we celebrate Worldwide Communion, let us be ever mindful of our communion with you through our thoughts and prayers, our words and actions as we go about our lives. Give us strength and courage and faith each and every day as we face the challenges of the world. We pray for special guidance and healing to Judy, Mark, Bob and Nancy, Dottie, Joan, Dale, Joe and family, Morgan, Jean, Lois, Paul, Marlene and Jim, Chris, Shirley, Sandra, Wayne, Bill, Pat, Tina, Jim, Carol, Kay, Louise, Joanne and Dan, Katie, Ron, Pat, Tricia, Claire, Joan, Rita, Terry, Nana, Sue, Naomi, Debbie, George, Tim, Barbara, Kay, our church and congregation, and for everyone dealing with the coronavirus. And now let us pray the prayer that you taught us. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen.
Received, knowing that we are one flesh with all humanity.